If you love wisdom, put your mind up to the ceiling. Don't let it stay in the gutter. Don't let your heart get all cluttered. No, no, I did not stutter. Listen to all that I've muttered. Your life will only go well if you win wisdom or lovers.
If you're in love with wisdom, come inside.
Come inside. Come inside.
The truth will surely rescue you and I.
You and I. You and I.
If you're in love with wisdom, come inside.
Hey, what's going on, everybody? This is your host, JC Johnson, and you are listening to For the Love of Wisdom, where philosophy meets the streets. And of course, you know you're listening on North Coast Underground, where the underground starts with you. Today is Thursday, and you know we're here every Thursday at 4 p.m. So today we're talking about the wisdom of prosperity. That's financial prosperity, mental prosperity, emotional. We're joined today by special guest Brian Nice. You don't want to miss it. We'll be right back after this.
If you're in love with wisdom, come inside.
Come inside.
Hey, what's going on, Wisdom family? Each week on For the Love of Wisdom, we promote a new and free audiobook that we believe you will benefit from and become wiser by listening to. On today's show, we're talking about the wisdom of prosperity. And so, the recommended book for this week is Rich Dad, Poor Dad by Robert Kiyosaki. This book is about re-educating yourself with financial information that you probably didn't learn in school. To download this free book today, just visit audibletrial.com/lovewisdom. Audible is spelled A-U-D-I-B-L-E. So that's audibletrial.com/lovewisdom.
This is your girl, Juicy Jazzo, and I wanted to let you know I'm all about wisdom. Knowledge is power, power is money, and money makes the world go round. And you're listening to For the Love of Wisdom right now, leading out your speaker.
Hey, what's going on, everybody? Welcome back. You are listening to For the Love of Wisdom, where philosophy meets the streets. All right, today we are discussing the wisdom of prosperity. We have a special guest, Brian Nice, who's going to be joining us. But before we get started, I want to make sure that everyone knows what we're talking about here. If it's your first time listening, we get the title of the show from the word philosophy. The word philosophy comes from the Greek word philosophos, which literally means love of wisdom. So that's what we're talking about. Last week on For the Love of Wisdom, we discussed a topic that is really important. We talked about the wisdom of ability. We discussed individuals who have intellectual and developmental disabilities. We also did a special Father's Day episode called The Wisdom of Paternity, and we honored fathers as well as, you know, provided insight into what a father's role is, what it should be, and how it affects us. So if you missed either of those three episodes, because there were three episodes there, don't worry about it, because you can always get those for free download on either iTunes, TuneIn Radio, Stitcher, Google Play, and soon you'll be able to also catch those on Spotify. So if you want to look up past episodes, just go online and look up For the Love of Wisdom, and you know, you can continue listening on whatever your favorite podcast platform is. Also, if you want to join today's conversation, or you just want to contribute to previous conversations, you can hit me up on Twitter. The handle is @LoveWisePodcast. And in your response, just make sure that you use the hashtag For the Love of Wisdom, and we can definitely chop it up. Today, we're discussing the wisdom of prosperity, and we're going to be joined by special guest Brian Nice. Okay, so he's going to be joining us by phone. You definitely don't want to miss that. But before we get Brian on the phone, we need to discuss what the word prosperity means and what it doesn't mean. Okay, so according to Merriam-Webster's dictionary, the word prosperity means the condition of being successful or thriving, especially economic well-being, right? And that's what most people think of when they think of the word prosperity. They think of financial prosperity. They think of wealth. And even though that is true, what we're going to be talking about today transcends just the financial. So what we're going to be talking about has to do with, you know, your mental health, you know, mental prosperity, mental hygiene. We're also going to be talking about prospering in your physical body, you know, making sure that you're eating the right foods, getting enough exercise, things like that. So all of these different elements are important. in order to be truly prosperous, right? You have to prosper in every area, not just one area. So if your health is bad, but your finances are good, that's still not a good situation. The better equation is good finances, good health, good mind. All of those things need to work together in order for a person to be whole. All right, so another definition comes from the Oxford Dictionary, and they actually provide some pretty good synonyms. Most people think of finances when they think of prosperity, but these words can also relate to everything else that we discussed: your physical health, your mind, wealth, success, profitability, affluence, riches, opulence, the good life, fortune, ease, plenty, welfare, comfort, security, well-being, luxury, all right? Now, all of these words can be related to all aspects of our life. And if these words represent your state of mind, if they represent your physical health, if they represent your financial hygiene, right? If all these things are true of you, then that means you are truly prosperous, right? And you don't have to necessarily have $1 million in the bank in order to be prosperous, right? The best way to be prosperous is to be a whole person, to be a person who has a balance. And that's what we're going to be talking about a little bit later with Brian. Some of the antonyms, since we looked at the synonyms, let's look at some of the antonyms. Some of the antonyms for the word prosperity, meaning the opposite, are hardship or failure, right? Now, of course, failure may sometimes lead to, and actually oftentimes leads to success, but that's not what this is talking about. This is talking about perpetual failure, you know, just a state of just utter disappointment and lack of success, right? But sometimes in life we do experience some failure, but if we persevere and we push through it, ultimately it leads us to prosperity. But failure is the opposite of prosperity, especially if one never gets up from that point. All right, so every week you know that we have a book of the week, and the book of the week for this week is Rich Dad, Poor Dad by Robert Kiyosaki. Okay, and I think that this is an excellent book. This is one of my favorite books. It's something I've read and reread so many times over the last few years, and I wanted to share with you a few quotes that stuck out to me from this book. Vitally important. He says, in school, we learn that mistakes are bad and we are punished for making them. Yet, if you look at the way humans are designed to learn, we learn by making mistakes. We learn to walk by falling down. If we never fell down, we would never walk, right? And that's kind of like what we were talking about earlier. Here's another great quote from Rich Dad, Poor Dad. All right, right here, Robert Kiyosaki says, I am concerned that too many people are focused too much on money and not on their greater wealth, which is their education. Again, talking about prosperity from a different standpoint. We're talking about educational prosperity here, all right? So then Robert Kiyosaki goes on to say, if people are prepared to be flexible, keep an open mind, and learn, they will grow richer and richer through the changes. If they think money will solve the problems, I am afraid those people will have a rough ride. Intelligence solves problems and produces money. Money without financial intelligence is money soon gone. All right. And that right there is true. Money comes and money goes, but money will go much quicker if you don't have financial intelligence, right? If you don't have educational prosperity. So that's a good one right there. Another one here is, he says, stop blaming me, thinking I'm the problem. If you think I'm the problem, then you have to change me. But if you realize that you're the problem, then you can change yourself, learn something, and grow wiser. Most people want everyone else in the world to change themselves. Let me tell you, it's easier to change yourself than everyone else. And that right there, man, that is powerful, because it is so true, right? You know, we might blame other people for why we're not successful or why we're not at a certain place in life. But if we can stop doing that, start taking accountability for ourselves, and we would go so much farther in life. All right. And here's a really good one right here. He said, there is a difference between being poor and being broke. Broke is temporary. Poor is eternal. And that is so true, right? Because being broke is something that you might go through. You might lose $100, but then you might be able to gain $100 back the next day. But being poor, it's saying that this is something that has to do with your character. This is something that is a perpetual state of being. It's a mindset, right? Because you may not have $1 million in the bank, but you can be rich in spirit. So a person who's rich in spirit, technically you can't call that person poor, regardless of their financial situation, because they have a wealth that's greater than anything that money can buy. More on that after this. You're listening to For the Love of Wisdom, where philosophy meets the streets. When we come back from the break, we are going to start our conversation with Brian Nice. Don't go anywhere. You're listening to North Coast Underground, where the underground starts with you. We'll be right back.
Hey, what's up? It's your girl Queen Z from the Queen Z Show, and you are listening to For the Love of Wisdom.
Today on For the Love of Wisdom, we're going to be talking about the wisdom of prosperity, but not just financial prosperity, but emotional and physical prosperity, as in bodily prosperity. Today, we're joined by special guest Brian Nice, and he's going to be weighing in on the conversation as we talk about these different types of prosperity. And as we speak, Brian, you just told me during the break that you're actually in the midst of ordering some food. Tell us about some of those food choices that you're making.
Eating right is essential. Like I was telling my man Jay, I haven't drunk coffee in the past 6 months, and I performed at Strathmore, which is this big facility, entertainment facility in Bethesda, Maryland. And it's a fantastic place, similar to like the Kennedy Center or Verizon in Bethesda, Maryland. So I performed there. I sung and I played piano. But one thing I had to do was I had to get my vocals straight. And by straight, as a singer, I mean without, you know, any phlegm or, you know, not to be nasty, but just being straightforward, mucus or anything like that. Like I was saying, Jay, to explain why I'm ordering from McDonald's right now.
Yeah.
I hadn't drunk coffee in the past 6 months, and that felt really good. Partly because of the sugar content. I stopped drinking it. Sugar, I believe, is a super culprit in terms of getting us fat, particularly in the African American race. It's pretty much in all fast food. So it has helped me tremendously. As a result, like, of stopping drinking coffee and really declining in my sweet intake, so that would include like brownies and ice cream and things like that, I actually lost 21 pounds of fat.
Wow.
Yeah,
that's a lot.
Yeah, man. Hey, man. When I saw the scale, I couldn't believe it. You know what I mean? I was like, wow, this is excellent. Something that, you know, to other people, when they see me, they're like, why are you happy you lost that? You weren't even fat in the first place. But to lose fat that is very close to your stomach is somewhat challenging, you know? So now I have 12% body fat. It was challenging for me to lose. I don't know if you've ever experienced that, Jay, trying to lose fat when you're not really stereotypically fat, so to speak.
Yeah, I know what you mean. But, you know, for those people that don't know the difference, explain the difference between losing weight and losing fat. You know, because a lot of times people just say, okay, I need to reduce my actual physical number, but is that the most important thing, or is losing fat the most important thing?
Losing weight is definitely not the most important thing, and I think that it's the wrong perspective. Usually when people are talking like that, they're being kind of hard on themselves because they don't understand the game of health, right? Like, and I think it's very important so that we don't end up condemning ourselves in the health arena, right? What you want to do is you want to destroy the unhealthy fat on your body, right? Like this, like around your arteries and things like that. Right. Losing weight in general is not really important, because you can have muscle that is also weight. So do you want to lose that weight?
Right, because, you know, as it relates to, you know, body mass index, a lot of times, you know, people don't take that into consideration. that,
right,
you know, just because your BMI is where it's supposed to be, or maybe because it's lower than where it's supposed to be or higher than where it's supposed to be, that in and of itself is not enough to really tell you where you're at health-wise. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, I'd say that that's an essential point that you're making. Like, for example, my body mass index right now is 28.2, I believe, the last time I checked it. I was told by the trainer who helped me get that read, he said that's a little bit higher than what it's supposed to be. But because you have more muscle than average. Thank you so much, sir. Yeah, so sorry about that. I was saying thank you to the guy here at the McDonald's window, ironically, after talking to you guys about health.
Right, right. Because, you know, McDonald's is the healthiest place to be.
Right, right. So why am I doing that? Well, for your listeners who want to know why I'm doing that, I'm struggling with asthma right now. I'm actually having a hard time breathing during this podcast.
Oh, sorry to hear that, man.
Hey, thanks. Yeah, but Jason and I, we're of the perspective that, you know, you got to keep on pushing through it. Like, you got to keep on doing what you got to do, you know. And
that's right.
That also ties into gym mentality of like health and the gym. But see, the thing about the gym is, even if I don't go to the gym now, I have days when I'm working primarily on my chest, my triceps. Chest, triceps, and shoulders. And then on the other day, I work on my back, my legs, and my biceps. And so if I don't make it to the gym, I still have to put some work in. I still have to target one of those areas, even if it's just 25 push-ups,
right,
to target my chest. And then on the following day, the idea is to get back into it. So then hit the gym again. But You're trying to make your goals easy. You don't want to, just because you can't make it to the gym, okay, cool. Well, knock out 25 push-ups at home. Or take a watermelon and do 5 curls with the watermelon. You know what I'm saying? On curl day.
Wow, watermelon exercises. I haven't heard that one.
Right, because the idea is that to be successful, we got to make it easy for ourselves. It's not about just being so hard on yourself, like, ooh, I gotta go to the gym and I gotta pump 250 pounds, you know. But, like, I think we overdo it. Like, we overdo the ideology.
But for those people that do make it to the gym, you know, a lot of times, you know, when I'm at the gym, you know, I see guys who are just so focused on, you know, bench pressing or, you know,
right.
just doing the upper body workouts, but you're talking about chest, you're talking about triceps, you're talking about biceps, a little bit of everything, quads and all that, right? So what's the importance of that, hitting the different parts of the body?
What you're saying is true. You see guys who are just focused on the upper body. I don't think that that's a good idea. What I try to do is focus on all aspects of the body, and I try to focus on compound movements as opposed to isolated movements. So rather than just look at your bicep like you're Arnold, what you want to do is, like, look at both of your biceps, take a flat bar, because there's something about that flat bar. I mean, you can do a curl bar, so you can variate. My point is, take a whole bar. Instead of doing single weights, try to focus on compound movements, because it's going to save you time. I aim for 45 minutes, compound movements, biceps, back, and legs day. I'm focusing all on compound movements, even if it's just the machine. You got the guys showing off doing the heavy weights and stuff. It's not about that. It's about consistency. Consistency is more important than, you know, showing off for one day. And to answer Jason's question, the importance of this is because you want to have a complete, healthy, aesthetic physique. Right, like
right.
So my goal is Beachbody. I'm not looking to be Phil Heath, who is Mr. Olympia. I want my body to just be one that's aesthetically pleasing. Like, if I were on the beach, or as an entrepreneur, if I'm taking a, you know, if I'm doing some type of some type of photo shoot,
right.
If I'm taking a photo with President Obama or with my man Jason Johnson here, you know, you have to craft your body parallel to your goals. So how do you want to look if you're taking a photo? with your favorite mentor.
Hey, that's some great wisdom right there. You are listening to For the Love of Wisdom, where philosophy meets the streets, with our special guest, Brian Nice, as he joins the conversation today as we discuss the wisdom of prosperity. And that's financial prosperity, mental prosperity, emotional prosperity, as well as biological prosperity. And when we come back from the commercial break, we'll continue. Thanks for listening. You are listening to NorthCoastUnderground.com, where the underground starts with you. And this is For the Love of Wisdom with your host, JC Johnson. If you want to join the conversation today, you can hit me up at my Twitter page, which is at LoveWisePodcast. Definitely hit me up. Today we are talking about the wisdom of prosperity. And always remember, if you miss an episode and you want to catch up on a previously aired episode, you can always listen online on iTunes, TuneIn Radio, Stitcher, or Google Play Music. All right, so just look up For the Love of Wisdom and you can catch it. We'll be right back after this.
It's your boy, Tear It Up, Tommy Tom from Beyond Sports, and you're listening to For the Love of Wisdom
with your host, Jason Johnson.
Welcome back. You are listening to For the Love of Wisdom on NorthCoastUnderground.com, where the underground starts with you. And I'm joined by my special guest, Brian Nice. What's going on, Brian?
Hey, what's going on, buddy?
Before we continue, tell us a little bit more about your remedy for allergies.
I have asthma and also have allergies. One thing that helps the asthma out that I found personally is, like, if I get something cold and then I get something hot, for some reason, it tends to make it a little bit easier for me to manage, like, whatever hot drink there is. That's what I got, you know, so I didn't order, like, any crazy fries or quarter pounder or stuff. I try to, like, keep the diet consistent.
Right.
Go ahead, Jay.
I was going to say that, you know, typically when people think of going to a fast food restaurant, I guess because of the negative connotation, it seems that you can only order something that's unhealthy. However, you were able to find some healthy alternatives that fit within your diet. And I think that that's pretty cool. And that's important when it comes to, you know, consistency.
Yeah, man. Like, so definitely, man. Like, I think I'm all about making things easier, right? So one thing that I think is very important for your listeners is, like, if you like Wendy's or anything like that, or like McDonald's, like, I prefer Wendy's to McDonald's. And so one thing that I've noticed is, like, they have something called a to-go wrap, which is a $2.09 chicken wrap, you know, so small piece of bread, whole piece of grilled chicken. They put the salad on it. So if you get that, instead of getting, a number six, but instead of getting, like, a Dave's Double with the fries, you've reduced your calories greatly. You're talking about, like, let's say 400 calories as opposed to, or 320 calories as opposed to 800 calories, which is very important, because if you're trying to lose weight, if you're a male, I think you shouldn't be going over 2,000 or 1,800. You want to aim at getting fewer calories from these fast food restaurants.
And, you know, it depends too on, you know, what your goals are, and also whether these are empty calories or good calories, you know, because there is a difference there. Why don't you just tell them the differences between that empty calories and good calories?
Okay, so if I'm eating a brownie, which I like 7-Eleven has these brownies that I do like a lot, but it's garbage, right? Like, I mean, this is not something that you want to consume every day. Because we're not talking about any valuable protein, we're not talking about any veggie source here, we're not talking about any food source, we're just talking about a brownie, which is, like, I believe the brownie last time I checked was like 400 calories, but again, I could be off, but it is empty, right? Like I said, there's no veggies there's no fruit there. One of my favorite fruits for summer that is not empty calories, it's fulfilling, it fills you up, right? And maybe water is watermelon. You know,
yeah,
watermelon, literally, I mean, you can feel full, you can feel satiated off of watermelon, and you're not getting a lot of calories. There is sugar in watermelon, but it's a good sugar as opposed to the sugar in a brownie or let's say a fried donut,
right? So it's not like processed sugar,
right?
Or you know, bleached sugar or anything like that. It's natural, straight from a plant.
Exactly. We're not talking about, no, like, crazy things like MSG, or high fructose corn syrup, right? So if I go to 7-Eleven, I get a Slurpee, I'm dealing with high fructose corn syrup. High fructose corn syrup. If I get a soda, Coca-Cola, I'm dealing with high fructose corn syrup, which, so anytime you see corn syrup, high fructose corn syrup, period, I go the other way. I try to get my juice from an orange as opposed to orange juice. That's a change I've made more recently, and I believe that helped me to get to a place where I only had 12% body fat, which is that one change. You know, I used to get orange juice and things like that, but why not really just get your juice from the actual fruit?
Hey, that's true. That's true.
Yeah.
And that's what people used to do. You know, we have all of the conveniences now because of, you know, processed foods and, you know, companies that take, I guess, a lot of the hard work. They do a lot of the hard work for you by producing these products. But the thing is, even though back in the day stuff was less convenient, maybe because you had to squeeze your own juice as opposed to being able to just go to a store and buy it. With all of these conveniences has also come a decline in the quality of these products, because in order for these products to, you know, meet FDA requirements and, you know, not to spoil too soon, they have to put preservatives and different things in them in order to, I guess, keep them alive. But really, that's not helping to keep us alive as people, is it?
Absolutely not. And one of the things that made me get on track with it is my dad having stage 4 prostate cancer. And I know that, unfortunately, Jason's dad also had cancer and recently passed. You know, definitely, we were very sad about that. You know, I gave my man Jason my condolences.
Right, thank you.
And that's very difficult. So, like, when you see that, when you see your own father, like, going through something like that and hurting, like, it really forces you to wake up, because we're the offspring of our parents, right? So we're essentially them. We're like the next Johnson, right? Or the next Nice, if you will. You see,
right?
So, but I tell you what. So I want to offer some like secrets, like, to your listeners that I believe really are beneficial. I already told you one of them. That's watermelon in the summer. Okay, another one is any green veggies. My specific go-to one is spinach. As far as your salt, try to add Himalayan salt. So you can take Himalayan salt as opposed to seasoning salt.
Wait, so are you saying I gotta take a trip all the way to the Himalayas just to get some salt?
Nah, man, Jason's a funny dude. you don't, man. Like, you can actually get Himalayan salt straight from the Aldi's or Giant, you know. But this salt is supposed to be better for you. As to the specifics, because Jason likes the specific, I actually don't know all the different specifics of why Himalayan salt is better. Listeners, feel free to look that up. If I'm wrong, you can email me, right? But I'm pretty sure I'm not wrong. Himalayan salt, that's one. But as far as my taste buds, we're talking about watermelon. What's the other one? Cinnamon, right? See, because sugar is a good culprit. Sugar is a big culprit. So here's my big one. Cinnamon. Replace sugar with cinnamon. What will happen is, here's what's going to happen. At first, if you're not used to cinnamon, or you think you don't like it, you might complain. But trust me, if you use cinnamon, let's say 4 days, you're going to actually notice, put it in your tea or your coffee, your tea is actually going to start becoming somewhat sweet to you. It like tricks your brain, man. I'm telling you, like the first day, you might just be like, I wish I had less sugar. But like 4 days into it, cinnamon naturally will make your drink or whatever you put it on actually start to taste sweet. Mm. Like, when I noticed this, I was shocked, man. I was like, whoa. This is crazy. And cinnamon has a lot of positive effects for your body. I won't even try to tell you all of them, because I don't want to get one wrong, man. But it's one of those natural things. I would go for cinnamon before I went for honey.
That's pretty interesting. I'll have to try that.
Yeah, you got to try cinnamon. You got to try cinnamon. And maybe when I come back, I'll tell you some more specifics about the positive effects of cinnamon. But as for now, I'm telling you, the positive effect that I want to let you guys know is that sugar is not good for you. Sugar actually is said to be linked to one of the primary causes of cancer. So you want to delineate sugar and use something that is natural, like cinnamon. You can also add ginger. Ginger is natural, too.
You know what? That's definitely some really good insight. I actually like ginger. So I want you to share a little bit more about that when we come back from the break. But definitely cinnamon as an alternative to sugar. I think that's awesome. That's a great takeaway for us. I think that that's something that I would like to start implementing myself, because I'm actually trying to make some health changes, really secure the future of my health. You know, right now we're young and we don't have any major health problems. And because of that, it's easy for us to neglect our health and doing those things that we know are good for us. But really, now is the time for us to start investing in ourselves. Today, we're discussing the wisdom of prosperity, and we're not just limiting that to financial prosperity as most people usually think or hear the word prosperity, but we're talking about prosperity in your physical body. We're talking about prosperity in your relationships, prosperity in your mind, mental prosperity, you know, mental hygiene. All of that is very important. None is more important than the other. We need all of it in order to be fully well-rounded people and to overall be healthy. Overall prosperity is important. And when we come back from the break, I do want you to touch on some of those other aspects of prosperity. You are listening to For the Love of Wisdom, where philosophy meets the streets, and you are listening on North Coast Underground, where the underground starts with you. We're gonna listen to a couple of songs and hear from our sponsors, and we'll be right back after this. Don't go anywhere.
Hey everybody, you're listening to For the Love of Wisdom, where philosophy meets the streets,
with your host, Jason Johnson.
All right, welcome back everybody. You are listening to For the Love of Wisdom, where philosophy meets the streets, and you're listening to NorthCoastUnderground.com, where the underground starts with you. Still with my special guest, Brian Nice. What's going on, Brian?
Hey, what's up, Jay? Happy to be on the show, man.
Yeah, and he's joining us all the way from Maryland, for those of you that are listening in Ohio or around the world. So, Brian, before the break, we were talking about some alternatives to sugar, and I do want you to finish the point that you were making there before we move on to the next topic. But what were you saying again about some alternatives that we can have? You had mentioned using cinnamon instead of sugar, how even psychologically it can begin to make a change in your mind once you begin using that alternative. It might actually start to taste as good as sugar to you. And you'd also mentioned ginger.
Yeah. So with that, man, yeah, definitely. Cinnamon is it's hard to describe, you know, in terms of how awesome it is. It's the first thing that I've used that is natural. You know, as all your listeners should know, that cinnamon is natural. And it's the first natural thing that I've used that seems to have tricked my brain into tasting it. To basically, like, thinking that it's sweet. You know, if I have tea, like, it's sweet, you know. You can use stevia, you can use, like, you know, fake sweeteners, man. But, I mean, cinnamon is natural, like, from the earth, you know.
And there's, you know, certain alternatives to it, even as it comes to just your, you know, health in other ways, not even just things that you digest. But, you know, one thing that my wife had mentioned to me, one thing that she likes to do is she makes, you know, homemade eye drops using natural honey. And actually, that's supposed to be really good for your eyes, and it can be even better than the different products that they have. This is actually something that's more natural, and it tends to yield even better results. So there's a lot of alternatives out there when it comes to food, when it comes to different products that we use on a daily basis. So it's really important to educate yourself.
Yeah. Hey, Jay, let me throw this in there, too. Honey, I would definitely say honey, but I would say honey in terms of sweetness, or like as a sugar replacement, I would go for honey after cinnamon, because the honey, if you're dealing with diabetes or anything like that, I believe honey can still spike your insulin levels to a degree.
Right.
But cinnamon has no sugar. So cinnamon first in terms of sweetness, but definitely for what Jason is saying in terms of like your eye or those kind of things like that, read up on the, you know, different things that you can do for honey for the purpose of sweetness, though. I go with cinnamon first. And your listeners need to know that God created your body in such a way that your body will get used to the new ways in which you train it.
Right.
So if you train your body to go for, let's say, watermelon as opposed to ice cream and Doritos when you get home from work as a snack, what will happen is the first day is going to be challenging. But, you know, you go 3 days into this, And your body will actually get used to it. I know this this from experience, you know, having right. lost 21 pounds of fat.
Yeah, that's definitely really good. And we appreciate you providing those insights. So just to transition a little bit, since we're on the topic of prosperity, you know, overall prosperity, prospering in your physical body, we're also talking about prospering mentally, but also prospering financially. Now, I want you to explain to the listeners, and I really do appreciate your time. I know you're getting ready for a business meeting right now, even as we speak, but
yes, sir.
I do want you to just to share a little bit about your journey as it relates to how you even got to this place of thinking about the importance of not only improving your physical health, but your financial health as well.
Yeah, most definitely, Jay. So we're talking about the journey here in several dimensions. When Jason said that, I was sort of thinking about a tripartial journey, which consists of spiritual, physical, which would be the health realm, and then also the financial or economical, material, paper, in which we need to take care of the physical, to take care of our health, and to provide for our families. And what I'm trying to essentially say is that I began to learn on my journey. I asked myself, and your listeners should ask themselves, what is the most important thing when it comes to life, and how would you order it? And for myself, the order would go like this. The most important thing is to honor God, right? It's to be on one accord with God, and we're not perfect all the time, but that's why God said we can ask for forgiveness, you know, and confess our sins. And so then after you move from the spiritual, okay, here's where it gets tricky for some people, which is more important, health or money? And I think that most people, it's tricky within their head until somebody really asks. And then when you ask them, of course they're going to say health. But then I don't know, Jay. Some might still say money. For me, I say health. If you lose your health, you can't get money. And why do you get money? Do you not get money to take care of your health, to take care of your family, to provide sustenance like, you know, a roof over your head, clothes on your body?
Yeah, absolutely.
If you're stuck in the hospital, you can't get money. So I say it in that order. Spirit, you know, spiritual health, physical health, and then money.
Right.
So now we're in the financial order. A little background real quick. Okay, I was 23. And my man Jason was evangelizing the gospel at University of Maryland. And his fire called fire to my fire, both on fire for the Lord Jesus Christ. So this was the spiritual realm. But as I got older, and my dad would say things like, hey, Brian, you need to study information systems. Hey, Brian, your mom is struggling financially. You need to assist her. Well, as a good boy, so to speak, a good Christian young man, that's going to affect you, right? Like, that affected me. That struck me like, wow, I need to be able to provide, you know, to assist my mom, to assist my dad. And so it began to strike a financial chord in me that I need to learn how to make money.
Right.
But the real journey of entrepreneurship for me did not even kick in until the age of 32. When I got a little bit older and my dad got prostate cancer, that's when it really began to kick in for me, just understanding that I need to really step up my financial game. And after applying to several different positions in which very successful people tried to help me get, I had one of my boys who was making over 100K, in between 100 and 200K. He was trying to help me get a job, and I was working my butt off. I mean, my job was to get a job within this 3-week span, and I was not successful doing so, and I knew that I had done it to my best ability. And I called my mentor, you know, Mr. Paul D. Piazza. I said, hey, man, hey, Paul, how should I do this? You know, like, what do you suggest I do? Should I be a lawyer like you? Or, you know, what should I do? My background is within family. Should I start working for an elderly population, baby boomers? And he said, Brian, what I want you to do, he said, I want you to take that gift of music. And you said that you wanted to teach, you wanted to start a business with teaching people, teaching kids and teaching adults. He said, that's what you need to do above the law school.
Right. So using your gifts, things that you're already operating in. Now, I think that's definitely really important. And I want you to continue that when we come back from the break. But Thank you for listening, everyone. You are listening to For the Love of Wisdom, where philosophy meets the streets. And we're about to conclude hour one of the show. So join us for hour two. We'll be right back.
Knowledge is power. Power is money. And money makes the world go round.
Money, power, respect. I'm getting higher, learning. Yeah, I'm winning. Only get better with time. Can got on my mind with wisdom. There's no limit. There's no limit. Get up and get it. Can achieve the impossible. Conquer every obstacle. Exhausted from grinding. Constantly pushing. Do what they say I couldn't. Life is what you make it. Knowledge is power. Don't let them take it.
If you're in love with wisdom, come inside.
Come inside. Come inside.
The truth will surely rescue you and I.
You and I. You and I.
If you're in love with wisdom, come inside.
Come inside. Come inside.
The truth will surely.